Hi, hello, good morning. Welcome back to the lecture series on Indian banking. So in this session, we are going to understand how technology enabled us in the modern banking system to transfer the funds from one person to another person and even from one bank to another bank branch. Okay? So now let's understand some of the platforms through which the modern banking system in which we are involved in transferring the funds. Okay, the first, National Electronic Fund Transfer. An electronic fund transfer is a financial transaction that takes place over a computer network. Okay. The process allows the consumers or customers of a bank to transfer funds between accounts within the same bank as well as across different financial institutions. The electronic fund transfers include direct deposits, wire transfers, direct debits, online bill payment services, ATM withdrawals, point of sale transactions, and many more. So in a typical electronic fund transfer, an automated clearing house network securely processes the financial transactions. Yes? Okay. So the automated clearing house is basically a secure transfer of funds. Okay, so this is the system that connects all banks such as credit unions and banks and other financial institutions. So now let's understand how it works. Transactions are processed by the bank through the automated clearing house network. The secure transfer system that connects all US financial institutions for payments, funds are transferred electronically from one bank account to the billing company's bank, usually less than a day after the scheduled payment date. So the transactions will be completed. The ACH network operates as a batch processing system. Financial institutions accumulate ACH transactions throughout the day, which are handled via batch processing later on. So that is the headache of the ACH. And now let's understand what are the basic benefits or advantages of this National Electronic Fund Transfer. So as we know that the customers need not to visit the bank branch where they have the account, so they can have the fund transfer. So it is useful for the bank also. How? It is this system, it enabled the banker to reduce the administrative expenses. Okay. Sorry, increase the efficiency of fund transfer, and it has very simplified bookkeeping accounting. Okay, accounting system in which all the transactions are kept in a books of account. Okay, so there is no manual involvement in maintaining the books of account recording the transactions are happening among the clients, among the bank customers. So therefore, so bookkeeping has made very simplified. Greater security. Okay, so it is a secure platform through which the customers of a bank, they could have exchange transactions, they could have making the payment and receiving the payment. Okay, now let's understand the different types of electronic fund transfer. Direct deposits, as you know, that the business houses. So whenever they want to make the payment for their employees with the help of this platform, so they could be able to make the payment. Wire transfers. So this system is used for non-regular payments, such as down payment on monthly basis for the house, okay, and making the payment towards the electricity bill, okay, and even mobile recharging. For all those activities, so the customers could able to depend on this system. ATMs. So this allows cash withdrawals and deposits, fund transfers, and checking the account balances at multiple locations, such as branch locations, retail stores, shopping malls, and even airports. Okay, so with the help of the ATM, so they could able to access these facilities. Fourth, debit card. It allows the users to pay for transactions and have those funds deducted from the account linked to the cards. It might be a credit card, a debit card, smart card, whatever it may be. Okay. Fifth type of EFT, pay by phone system. This system allows the users to pay bills or transfer money over the phone. Online banking, it is available via personal computers and tablets, and even the smartphones, which can be used for making the transactions through this mode. So now let's understand another important MIC or codes. Similar to the IFSC code for each and every commercial bank and for their branches, the magnetic ink character recognition code also plays an important role in the financial system, especially the country like India. It helps in processing the payments, so through checks, through drafts, or through electronic mode. As its name suggests, it is a part of a character recognition technology that is used by the banking industry for clearing and processing of checks, which are considered as genuine checks. MICR code is provided on each check leaf and is printed at the bottom of each check leaf. It is a 9-digit numeric code that helps in identifying the bank and the branch of the bank where the account is maintained, and the other details needed for the processing of those checks, okay, in the settlement and making payment. The use of this code has helped to reduce the time taken to clear the check payments, okay, and it has also helped the bank employees to get rid of the burden of entering the details of the checks whenever the checks are presented for collection, whenever the checks are presented for withdrawal, okay, processing. It will be easy for the bank employees when there is a MICR code. Unlike the barcodes, the characters present in the check, that is called MICR code, can be easily read by humans without lot of effort. So these are the benefits of MICR codes. It will be easy for the banker to recognize the particular check belongs to particular customers, okay, so no need of going through the customer's name and searching their details, okay. It will be easy for the bankers, by bank employees, to make the process towards the check payment. Now let's have a look on this, okay. So just go through the Access Bank, where the MICR code is given and the IFSC code is also given at the top towards the left. Okay. Now let's move on another important payment platform, RTGS, Real Time grass settlement. Okay, it is a fund transfer method through which money is sent in real time basis without any delays. So this electronic fund transfer system allows the money sent by the remitter to immediately reach the beneficiary. Then grass settlement refers to the processing of transactions on an individual basis and not in a batch wise system as in the case of the NFT. But it is typically meant for larger value transactions. Huge transactions will be happening with this platform, and the minimum amount so that could be sent via this mode is up to 2 lakhs. Maximum limit is no. There is no maximum limit for transferring the funds from one account to another account. Okay. Money can be sent using RTGS through network banking. To initiate such as transactions, it is important to collect some details from the beneficiary, such as account name of the beneficiary, bank name, okay, and IFSC code and account holder name. So these are the informations required in order to make the payment towards any beneficiary through this RTGS mode. Another interesting feature about this wire transfer method is that transactions can be scheduled in advance. See, the RTGS payment system is maintained by Reserve Bank of India and hence is a safe and reliable method of transferring the funds. Okay, is it clear? Okay, now how does it work? How the process will be happening? Okay, what are the steps involved in fund transfer through RTGS? Number one, first step, log into your respective bank's internet banking account by entering your username and password. Okay, so with the help of the internet banking, by using your username and password, you can enter into the your internet banking account. Number two, second step, go to the home page and click on the funds transfer option. Third, proceed to choose RTGS, key in beneficiary details such as account name, IFSC code, etc. Regarding the PE or beneficiary. Fourth step, review all details and then submit. Okay, the fund will be credited immediately to the beneficiary account. Okay, so this is the process which is happening through this RTGS. Now let's understand some few details regarding the transactions charges. Okay, so now rupees 2 lakhs and up to 5 lakhs. Okay, the fees is just 30 rupees per transactions. Okay, and above 5 lakhs, rupees 55 per transaction is charged by the banker. So this is all about what is called the fee and charges. Okay, and now let's understand what are the timings of RTGS, what are the timings allowed for the clients, for the bank customers to have this system through which the transactions will be happening. Working days at present 7 to 6 p.m. 7 a.m. to 6 p.m. Saturdays at present from 9 to 2 p.m. Okay, so this is simple the timings and as well as the fees, fee and the charges which will be imposed by the bankers to the customers whenever they have transferring the funds through this system. So now let's have a distinguish between RTGS and NEFT. Okay, settlement. As far as NEFT transaction is concerned, settlement will be done in batches. Okay, but as far as RTGS is concerned, transactions will be settled down individually, immediately. Okay, there is no delay in it. Timings. Settle on an hourly basis during banking working hours. Okay, so otherwise it is difficult, as I told you the timing and all. Okay, RTGS processed immediately in real time basis. Transaction amount, no limit, no minimum limit, but has a maximum limit of 2 lakhs. Okay, so in the case of the NFT. And as far as RTGS is concerned, minimum 2 lakhs could be transferred by the customers to any account. But there is no ceiling to the transfer of the funds from one bank to another bank. Okay, and value meant for lower and medium range transactions will be happening in this forum. And RTGS is meant for higher value transactions, like huge transaction, 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs, 50 lakhs, 1 crore. Okay, so this is the system, that is this is the distinction, so that we could able to find out between these two platforms because of the modern technology. NEFT is a typical electronic fund transfer method where settlements are made on a deferred net settlement basis. Okay, so this basically means that when it comes to the NEFT transactions, settlement does not take place unless certain number of transactions are received till a certain cutoff time. But as in the case of the RTGS, transactions are processed as and when so they are received. Okay, for instance, NEFT, in the case of the NEFT, NEFT, if you initiate the fund transfer after a settlement time, you have to wait for the next settlement time for the transactions to be processed. Okay, so this is a slight difference that we have between these two platforms. So now let's understand. So there are basically three types of fund transfer methods, especially the country like India: NEFT, RTGS, IMPS. Well, NEFT and RTGS are regulated and managed by the Reserve Bank of India. The IMPS system is brainchild of the National Payments Corporation of India. That means regulatory authority towards IMPS transactions is NPCI. NEFT is mainly for lower value of the transactions, fund transfers not settled immediately. Okay, so the services are also not available on bank holidays and Sundays. Okay, so there are 11 batches on weekdays and 6 batches on Sundays. So there is no minimum amount, but there is a ceiling cap or the maximum limit of the fund transfer, as in the case of the NEFT. RTGS transactions are concerned, as far as RTGS transactions are concerned, they are settled on a real-time basis, and there is a minimum limit but no maximum limit, as in the case of the RTGS. Banks have the liberty to decide their own upper limit, as the RBI has not set any ceiling cap towards the RTGS transactions. IMPS services are also available on 24/7 basis at any time of the day and night. Okay, when it comes to NEFT and RTGS, fund transfer cannot be initiated on the bank holidays or even on Sundays, but it is not in the case of the IMPS. All IMPS transactions can be made on all 365 days in a year at any time and from anywhere. Okay, so this is the basic differences between the RTGS, NEFT and IMPS, right? So these are the, so for 2 marks the questions may appear in the examination. What is the difference between NEFT and RTGS? What is the difference between RTGS and what is called IMPS? So like that, the question may appear in the examination. Okay, so just understand the concept very clearly, then it will be easy for you to write the answer in the exams. Okay, now DMAT account. Students, have you heard about this, the word DMAT account? The word DMAT is dematerialized account. Okay, the word DMAT is a colloquial short word for dematerialized account, which is a type of account where shares and other securities which are electronically transfer from one person to another person, from one business house to another business house. Okay, which enable trading, transactions and settlement in the stock exchanges, okay, secondary market, okay. So in the secondary market, so whenever the transactions are happening, transactions in the sense transactions of shares, debentures, bonds, etc., okay, so for that it is necessarily one has to open demat account, so thereby it eliminating the need of physical financial instruments like shares, debentures, bonds, etc. Okay, it was in the year 1996 when it was first introduced in our country after the introduction of depository system by the Depository Act of 1996. It is mandatory for one to own a demat account with an investment broker linked to a savings or other funded account. If he or she wants to participate in the stock market for trading, okay, so it is necessarily, so there must be demat account. Okay, so the interested candidate need to approach depository participants, which acts as an intermediary between the traders and investors. Okay, so a depository participant will be registered with the Central Depository Services. Okay, any depository participants that has been registered with CDSL, okay, and the National Securities Depository Limited. So these two are the two important depositories. They provide the depository services in our country, in the stock exchange or secondary market. The DPs are basically the stock broking firms. They are called stock brokers. Some banks works as a stock broker, and some brokers will be appointed by the broking firm, okay, with whom one needs to get registered, which needs some identity proof and other documents for verification, and on its completion provides the trader with login credentials and transaction passwords, upon whose confirmation the transfers or purchases of the shares could then be initiated. One can operate the transactions of buying and selling of shares by own or through the broker personally or online from the demat account. Okay, so nowadays, so demat account is enough. So with the help of the broker, anybody can participate in buying and selling of the shares in the capital market, in the stock exchange. The broker then provides the candidate with the transaction password to carry out the share trading processes. It is possible for a firm to hold more than one demat account also with the depositories. Okay, share trading using the demat account involves inward and outward brokerage, which varies from broker to broker usually. So nominal charges will be imposed by the brokers for their transactions, okay, on trading cycle, whether intraday or delivery. Okay, so now let's understand what are the features of demat account. Easy accessibility and mobility in stock trading, okay, by sitting any corner of the globe. So through the demat account, with the help of the brokers, they could be able to have the exchange transactions, okay, buying and selling of the securities could be made easy. Utmost security is ensured while trading, debarring loss, forgery or theft, okay, of the certificates. Okay, so this type of loss for the people who are involved in trading of securities and forgery and theft, it is not at all happening. Okay, it's all white and black. It is completely reduced the paperwork and minimizing the risks involved in the transactions. Okay, no stamp duty is required on transfer of shares, and lower cost per transactions by the brokers, so than the physical trading of securities. Okay, so now there is no physical trading of securities, there is no a physical transfer of the securities. Okay, so this is happening in demat account. Now let's understand the differences between the demat account and trading account. Okay, usually, so basic difference between these two is whenever you are involved in trading of securities, you need to open the demat account. Okay, so whenever the people who are involved in buying and selling of the commodities in the commodity market, so there is a necessary to open the trading account. Okay, trading account is mandatory for the participants in the commodity market, and the trading of securities in the stock exchange, it is demat account is mandatory. It is a basic difference. Okay, it is often observed that the people either confuse the word demat account and trading account, or sometimes use these two words are interchangeably, which actually happens to be entirely two different terms. Now let's understand the basic difference between these two. Okay, so number one, demat account, as I told you, only allows the investors to store the shares and securities in an electronic form. Okay, whereas a trading account is used to place buy and sell order in the commodity market. Okay, now second, demat account holder needs to pay annual maintenance charges, but as in the case of the trading account, so this could be used, as I told you, it is placing an order to buy and sell of any securities, gold, okay, wheat, barley, okay, all those things and even the non-agriculture commodities also. For one to have the demat account, it is mandatory to get an approved by SEBI. SEBI has to approve opening the demat account, and NSDL has to be approved for the person, one who wants the trading account. Okay, but in the case of the trading account, so there is not necessary to get the approval from any statutory bodies. Okay, and SEBI and NSDL, so both have to approve for it is mandatory for the account holder, especially the demat account. Okay, demat account is useful for those who are interested to invest in stock market only, whereas trading account is basically suitable for derivative segments. Okay, derivative market, it is called commodity market segment. Traders most likely they exchange commodities for money, and in indexes and currency futures and options and swaps. Okay, so these are the different kinds of commodity segments. Okay, so which are underlying assets which could be traded with the help of the trading account. Thus, the people who are inclined towards dealing in shares and securities in the secondary market in the country, especially the country like India, should make sure that he or she is fully aware of its root level knowledge. Otherwise, it is very, very difficult to participate in buying and selling. So therefore, in order to discover the wealth show with wit and not fluck. Okay, so with this, so let's conclude with these few concepts, understanding with these concepts. So with this, we have successfully completed the portion. So only the thing is, so being a faculty, being a teacher, I have completed my responsibility, but being a student, you cannot transfer your responsibility on somebody's shoulder. No, it's not possible. You have to bear your responsibility, and the things like that, you have to study hard, smart, and get good marks in the examination. Okay, so have a good day. Thank you for listening. Bye.